Again, welcome guests to discuss police and security in and around particularly the London Stadium. We got near the end. We had to do that sort of business. I make no apologies for that. So, again, we've got a number of guests here today, more than we would normally have, and that's partly about the importance of the issue, but partly because the number of parties and interests, shall we say, around that area. It's important we have the right number of people. So I'll start the morning. Now, clearly we're here. I mean, I'm a football person, so, you know, I was around in the 70s and 80s. I understand the history of football violence, and over the last 20 or 30 years, we've gone away from that. And I think there's some incidents around the stadium this year that I think Londoners are taking an interest in, and we have responsibility around scrutinising safety in London. So I think it's an appropriate subject for us today to take a keen interest, not just in London Stadium itself, but in the wider area. And we've got colleagues from Westfield and elsewhere today to talk to us. So I will start, if I may, with the first question, reflecting particularly around the recent or this season's violence within and around the stadium. So probably best to Linda initially, and then I'll bring in BJ, is how many of West Ham United's football matches at the stadium to date have resulted in significant levels of disorder or violence?
Good morning, Chair. So just to explain, I'm the Chief Exec of London Stadium 185. We are the operators of the stadium, which means that we are responsible for providing the services in the stadium, the catering, the stewarding, security, for example. I think in terms of what we have seen in the stadium, and you asked the question about significant levels, I think this has to be borne in mind, very much as you were saying, in the context of what's happening in football across the country. We had one match, which was the Chelsea match, where there was actually 6 arrests. That was the one match which I think probably elicited some headlines. But I think if you put it into perspective, there's only been 18 arrests so far, only 9 of which were West Ham fans. If you look at that pattern and you compare it with the Boleyn ground last year, that's on a par. And we've got over, 25,000 extra people now in this stadium. I don't know if Commander Harrington
I'll come back on that. So it's great you introduce yourself, because we've got a number of guests. When you do come in first, or to be helpful to members, to remind us the context of the organisation where it sits. So you said the number of arrests this season is comparable to Upton Park Bowling Ground last season in numbers, but that would, and again I've been in BJ, that would have, I'd like some clarification probably from the police on that, because violence within football grounds has kind of gone away. My sense of it is within grounds is largely a thing of the past. And I think that's been a great success for London particularly, and other parts of the country. And we'll have issues later about costs and things that Andrew and others are going to come into. So your comments are the violence within London Stadium has been comparable to last season. Would you say
that? And I'm not saying that is, you know, violence that's what is it a really sounded strong like. Word,
that's what it
isn't
sounded
it?
Like, yeah.
Chair, I just wonder if I could come in for a moment. David Goldstone, I'm the Chief Executive of the London Legacy Development Corporation. So we're the development corporation for the whole area in which the stadium sits, and have the sort of wider regeneration responsibility. And as you say, we have got a number of parties here, because we have got different responsibilities in relation to the stadium. And I think if I could just make 2 or 3 points, if you like, just by way of context for the whole discussion. I think, we first of all, and this may be obvious, but I think it's important to say, we all feel like absolutely committed that the safety and security of people visiting the stadium, visiting the park and the wider area on match days, as all other times, is absolute paramount priority. It has been a really small number of people who have misbehaved and have caused some headlines, but we've had over 500,000 visitors to the stadium this season. We had over 500,000 visitors to the stadium last summer for a series of other events. And I think, as Linda said, 18 arrests in the 11 games so far, with 500,000 people attending. It is a small number. It is too many. Obviously, we all want to reach the point where there's no such incidents. But it is at a low level, and obviously the police will be able to compare more broadly to other matches and other venues. But it is a small number. We're not denying there haven't been some issues. There have, but obviously we're in the context of a new stadium that's a new venue for football. It's within the park, which is a new venue for sort of hosting a stadium. And there's been a bit of getting used to those new arrangements, new teams of stewards, new policing, obviously West Ham moving to a new ground. But we do feel like that the misbehaviour is a fault of the people who've been misbehaving. We don't think the stadium has caused it, or the police have caused it, the club haven't caused it. It's misbehaviour of some individuals. We're all here because we're all working really closely together to try and absolutely minimise and eradicate those issues as far as possible. We're putting in arrangements, as we have learned from those early games, and we can talk about those in more detail, but there's a range of areas which have already helped improve the position and make sure that match day incidents are minimised, and that's been really close working between the police, Linda's team at LS185, the club, and all of the parties here. So I think, you know, we do feel like we've made really good progress. There have been actually only a relatively small number of incidents anyway, but we've already got a number of improvements in place that will help make that position even better. And I would also just, my last thing, the stadium is a really big part of the wider legacy and the regeneration of the area we're bringing. It does bring great numbers of people and activity and economic benefit to the local community, and there's that side that we wouldn't want to lose either.
Thank you. Well, we understand that the stadium is used for a range of events, and what we're trying to understand is the aspect that of West Ham using it, and how does that work?
Yes.
Whereas there are many, many other events within the stadium where there probably isn't problems. We can get on to later about some of the design around it. So some of the disputes was around seating. So you were, and I think you can probably come in later, but you were placing people who are used to standing in places where they weren't allowed to stand, and then there was a friction. And as a football person, I understand that.
Now, well, BJ, can I
get that completely.
We can deal with that issue.
I want to hear from the police anyway.
Of course.
BJ, could you comment a little bit specifically around the violence within the ground? Is that unusual? Is that unusual compared to other London football clubs? Tell us a bit about the context of what you've seen this season.
Thank you, Chair. If I can, I'd introduce myself. BJ Harrington. I'm the Chief Officer with Strategic Lead for Policing Football in London. If I deal with, we've had 11 matches that have all been policed at the London Stadium this year, and only four of those have resulted in any form of disorder. I think it's really important to deal with the facts for me. Only one of those have we seen violent disorder reported, and that was the Chelsea game, which I think everybody saw the very clear and unacceptable behaviour and the deployment of police and the work of stewards and a number of arrests as a result. There have been 18 arrests within the stadium, nine of those of which have been West Ham fans or declared themselves as West Ham fans. But I would, for the panel's benefit, to say that the most serious offence is violent disorder that's been recorded at the Chelsea game. The most serious other recorded offences have been actual bodily harm. So whilst unacceptable, this disorder has been localised. And if I was to put that in comparison with other forms of disorder that we deal with in London, I would suggest that, it's important, it's significant, but this significant disorder, I think, is something that I wouldn't describe it as such, with the exception of the Chelsea game. And I would stress there have been seven matches where there has been no issues and no disorder. In answer to your question, how does this relate to other stadiums and the police, wider policing of football? Well, there is only other two incidents that compare with the Chelsea game that I could report from this season. One was at Tottenham versus West Ham on the 19th of November, where there were 23 arrests, and also Brentford versus Reading on the 27th of September. And these are the only other significant issues in London where I would say that is serious disorder. So in terms of your question, on par with some other clubs, this is unusual in terms of that. In comparison with last year, difficult to compare, different seasons, different. But if we looked at the four matches, Bournemouth, Watford, Southampton and Sunderland, which West Ham played at the Boleyn Ground last year and have played at the London Stadium this year, there were four arrests at those matches. There have been four arrests at those matches this year and no arrests at those matches last year. So a direct comparison. Chelsea, very different because of the cup dynamic, the home derby position. So is this unusual? Yes, it is. And I'd come back to the point that there is lots of learning in terms of both a new partnership new individuals, new challenges in a stadium which has 25,000 extra fans. We are not, neither the people attending are familiar with their norms of routes, so things from a policing perspective, flashpoints, areas where we would expect problems, we just don't understand those because the people attending themselves are developing those. And so, of course, we've had to work together to get to a point where we understand them and deal with those challenges. And I would conclude by saying that if you look at the results from the Stoke game, where that partnership has matured, the things we've learnt together we've put in place, whether that's policing, the stewarding, the stadium, the club, and you will see what was a Category C, a high-risk fixture in terms of potential disorder, there were no issues, and there was no disorder. And a final point, Chair, I'd make is, you know, the real issue here is about a small but significant minority of people who associate themselves with football, in this case West Ham, and I must stress other visiting supporters who are intent upon crime and disorder. And that is at the core of this issue. And that's why we arrest and are working so tightly with our partners to prevent these people and exclude them from ruining football.
I'm going to bring in a minute, Karen, I'd like to come in, Baroness, to comment from a West Ham Football Club point of view. But I want to mention in a minute that Deputy Chair is going to come in and talk about outside the ground, because we know that whilst many football clubs have managed well within the grounds over the years, that has often push the violence outside, and the Deputy Chair is going to talk about that. But I've got two points before Cam Brady can come in. Is one thing is about there isn't problems within football grounds at the moment because of the segregation has improved so much over the years. And one of the problems, and I shall be visiting West Ham later in the season when my club goes there, but one of the problems perhaps is around the design of the ground, whereby the segregation between fans isn't perhaps what it should be. So perhaps you'd like to comment on that. And secondly, my last point, and then again I've been carrying in, is obviously the Chelsea game was a high-profile game, and as a policing and safety aspect, there will be other potentially high-profile games, which will be high-risk. You may have cup games against one or two teams that you particularly don't get on with. I'd like your thoughts around that, about managing the high-risk games. So it's the segregation piece and also the high-risk games, your thoughts around that, and then West Ham can comment. BJ, do you want to comment on that?
Chair, segregation's in my area later.
Okay, but I've got it in my head. I just want to ask a direct question as a football person. I understand that. If you could just briefly touch upon segregation, we'll explore it a bit later.
The first point I'd make is, you know, the key issue here is this core minority of fans who are intent upon disorder, and will work around whether it's the police or try and evade any kind of control in order to engage in disorder. The stadium itself, the segregation has developed through the season. You know, if you look at the Stoke game, I'm entirely satisfied and think it's highly effective, and we saw that at that game where there was no issues, and the segregation line has been developed and built. I think this is a case of learning with the design of the stadium, and also the design, the way that the police and stewards and the club have worked together to ensure that segregation is effective.
And highlighting, targeting particular games, anticipating during the season there'll be high-level games that you'll have to put special arrangements in. We'll get on to that a little bit later around costs. And
I would say that you know, the proof was in the Stoke game. That was a high-profile game, a high-risk game in terms of policing perspective. Mm. The segregation that was put in place by the stadium, working with West Ham, and in terms of the police support, that was highly effective. Right. And I think that's the model that we've now accepted as a partnership, that where the risk of disorder at the stadium is high, and that we will put those measures in place. And I think I have my colleagues here would agree that that's the plan we've got.
This is one of the areas I was referring to where there has been improvement already implemented from early learning. And actually it is a joint working and a joint approach that was adopted by the club with Linda's team at LS185 and the police. The segregation is now different to how it was at the start of the season.
That
it
more
is
fully,
wider
David.
And
yeah.
More enhanced.
Okay. Karen, sorry, would you like to comment on just the scene setting of your take, the club's take on what was the problems and how you're kind of addressing it?
Well, I think we all accept there were teething problems, as there always are when you move to a new stadium. And let's not forget, it's one of the biggest stadia in the country. To put some perspective around it, as already Linda and BJ Harrington have done, the 18 arrests, 9 were West Ham supporters, and that's in the 11 matches so far this season. And just to give the panel some context, There was a game, Aston Villa, a couple of weeks ago, and at that one game there were 18 arrests, 14 arrests, and at Rangers there were 18 arrests. And we're coming up now to about the halfway point of the season. So there's 18 arrests at West Ham, and just to give again the panel some perspective, Arsenal had 60 arrests for the whole season last year, and Manchester United had 57 arrests. We accept that any kind of disorder is disruptive to us, to our supporters' enjoyment of the game, which is why we're working so closely with both the police and the operators to eradicate it. But we want to put some sort of perspective into it. We have learnt from some of the issues that we have implemented strong and decisive action, and we are as adamant as the police are and the operators are that we want to eradicate the problems.
Okay, that's helpful. Thank you very much. Andrew, did you want to come in on this particular?
Yes, but I wanted to ask BJ about the College of Policing document in a minute, but before I do that, I mean, just on arrests, when I saw those films of violence on the TV inside the ground and so forth, there was rather more than half a dozen people involved in it. Just you didn't get to catch them, isn't that right?
There's been 18 arrests inside the stadium. To date, following the inquiries, there's 27 arrests in total. That's both in the ground and away from that. There is an ongoing inquiry, Operation Stowe, which is looking at all the CCTV footage, working with the club and London Stadium 185 to identify people whose behaviour is unacceptable so that the club and the stadium can ban them. Where we can use that intelligence and information to apply for bans where it's on intelligence basis under Section 14B of the Football Spectators Act, where we don't have to have a crime committed. We are looking at identifying another 18 people from various incidents to identify those, to make the arrest and to seek both criminal convictions and also alongside that, if we seek the conviction, to get bans against them.
So the number of arrests so far is not an indication of the extent of the problem?
The number of arrests inside the stadium is factual, Andrew, I'll be clear about that. There have been 27 arrests in total related to the whole West Ham policing operation, and that is a broad footprint, as you know. And there will be more arrests as we identify further people, because as you saw from the footage, there were more people than have been arrested involved. We need to identify them, we need to get the evidence against them, and as I said, back to my point about being a small minority of people who are ruining football, the right thing is to make sure we convict them where they commit criminal offences and get them banned from football.
Okay. Well, I wanted to ask you about the College Policing authorised professional practice. Does that apply to these arrangements?
In what respect, sorry?
Well, I'm going to ask you some questions about it. But the College of Policing has produced a document called Authorised Professional Practice, Public Order Policing Football. Does that apply here?
It will do, yes.
Right, OK. Good. Well, I think you're the police commander, Force Football Policing Lead. I think that's what you said.
That's correct.
Right, OK. So the various duties set out for you in the College of Policing document, and one of which is to ensure the right paperwork's in place. So I was going to ask you whether the four documents which the College of Policing recommend are actually in place here. So first of all, is there a statement of intent which has been put in place? The statement of intent with the football club, which reflects the division of responsibilities, including when to take primacy, e.g. during major incidents. Is there one of those in place?
We haven't got a statement of intent in place with the club, nor a special policing service arrangement in place with the club.
You haven't?
Not at this stage, no.
Right. So the next thing I was going to ask you was, have you got the charging agreement in place with the club?
No, there's no special policing service agreement under Section 25 of the Police Act in place at this stage. However, for the Stoke game and
going I'll be coming on to the detail of charging later on.
But in answer to the question, to give a full answer to that question, we have an agreement now with LS185, the operator, that we will have a match-by-match agreement around Section 25 special policing services. There was one in place for the Stoke game. There is one in place for the game on Saturday.
Right. I'll be coming to that in more detail later on this morning. So that's two documents that don't exist at the moment. Have we got...
Sorry, Chair, can I just say, there is no special policing service ongoing in place. For the game against Stoke, there was a special policing service agreement in place. There is a special policing service agreement in place for this Saturday's game. And by a match-by-match basis between the London Stadium 185 and the Metropolitan Police, where it is required on the advice of the match commander and special policing services are requested, we will make those agreements
match-by-match basis.
So they are in place where required.
Okay. Have we got an information sharing agreement with West Ham?
Not as I'm aware of, no.
No, right. Public order command structure, I presume you do have?
Absolutely. There will be, for every match, there is a public order command structure put in place, gold, silver and bronze, and a suit-based right. operation that's proportionate to the threat that's posed.
Okay, so what's in your control you've got? But two of the key documents, and it's called key document by the College of Policing, the statement of intent and the information sharing agreement you don't have, and the charge agreement, the third one, is on a case-by-case basis.
The special policing service agreements are being made on a case-by-case basis.
So that's, to my mind, a matter of concern that we've got a College of Policing document here setting out good practice, and it's not happened.
Yeah.
Open question, I suppose. In relation to the charging agreement, for the special, whatever it's called, can we see a copy of the one that you've got so far?
I haven't got that here with me at the moment.
No, but I mean, I wouldn't expect you to have them.
You can, of course you can, yes.
I think that would be helpful. But I am concerned that those key documents don't exist. The statement, it sets out here in the detail what they should cover. And I think it is rather surprising that that's not been done so far. Also in the College of Policing document, it refers to the definition of risk and non-risk supporters. And it says there must be specific reference to the actual risk posed by individuals or groups in the descriptions. Has that been done?
Yes, so every game there is an assessment based upon a national matrix which covers a number of factors which I can list, which looks at what the gradings of those games are. And Chair, if I can come back with that point, for every match this season there has been an assessment of the threat that the games have posed. There's been work with the stadium operator to agree a proportionate policing operation with a command structure where we've been able to charge under the guidelines, and I'm sure you'll come on to those. We have charged for those services, for the things we're allowed to charge for, and wherever police have been called to discharge their responsibilities, prevent and detect crime, protect life or property, or keep the Queen's peace, there has been an operation in place to do those.
Good, okay. Well, we'll come to charging later on, so there'll be quite a few questions about that, I'm afraid. looking at the two games so far, the Stoke game and the Chelsea game, were those assessments done of the risk posed by individuals and groups done for both those games?
When we make an assessment, there is a number of factors that are brought into question in relation to that. It's the history of the clubs, it's the stadium, it's the numbers of people attending, and a number of factors which come together to come to a grading system as to whether it would be C, high risk of disorder, or indeed police free, which is obviously the aspiration for all of these games where it's appropriate.
See, what the guidance says is that, it's not guidance actually, it's rather stronger than that, it's professional practice. It is essential that risk in relation to individuals and groups is quantifiable and dynamically assessed. The description of a group or individual as a risk is not sufficient on its own. There must be a specific reference to the actual risk posed by individuals or groups. Has that been done for those two games?
For every single game, yes it has, Chair. For every single game, there is an assessment of the match itself in its entirety on a number of factors to give it a grade from A through to C being the highest risk. Where there are specific individuals that are identified, we would take specific action. So, for example, if we knew someone was on banning orders, we would, and we knew they were attending, we would be actively briefing to look for those people. And where we had any intelligence that there were specific issues, we would seek to identify that. We deploy dedicated officers who we call spotters, who are familiar with working with different groups of supporters to identify people who we know are either concerned with or have an affiliation to the disorder that we talk about. We monitor those, we engage with those, we deter them from taking part, and where they commit offences, we intervene to prevent that. So I would say, answer that question, proper and thorough risk assessments, proper and thorough grading, both around the game in its entirety, and also about individuals, where those individuals are identified as posing a threat to crime and disorder.
Okay, thank you.
You've got a couple of questions about the wider context outside the ground.
Thank you, Chair. Quite a few questions. Chair, I must firstly emphasise, and something that you touched upon in your introduction, that this investigation is not just about disorder in and around the stadium. It's actually about policing and security issues concerning the park as a whole. We've got an iconic venue in the stadium itself. We've got Westfields. But we also have a growing number of housing developments and a growing community. And I really want to take the focus away from the stadium, if I can. And my first set of questions is to you, Commander. What is the policing strategy for the park generally, the park as a whole? And how does it differ on match and non-match days and for other events. You also talked about, in answer to the chair's question, you talked about our partnership maturing. Well, how do you work with others like Westfields, for instance? Can you give examples of this? Of what you described as a partnership maturing. And where is the nearest operational police station?
Pardon, sorry, I didn't hear the last part.
Where is the nearest operational police station?
I'll deal with those questions in two parts, really. My responsibility is around policing football.
Yep.
So I can clearly, there is a clear strategy in place for policing football across London. I have that here. I write that strategy. That applies to the whole football policing operation. Yep. In terms of the policing of the wider park on non-match days, that is a matter that is dealt with by the local borough commander in terms of Newham Borough. I know there's a dedicated police team in place. I do not have and have not seen the strategy for policing that. And do not have that to answer that question now. And in all honesty, I don't know what the nearest operational police station is. When my officers are deployed in terms of football policing, they are deployed to the ground in the environs and controlled from central London.
Sorry, I mean, I don't want to be critical, but when you were invited to this meeting, presumably you were told about what the scope of the investigation is, what we are looking at.
Yes, I was given some information around what the scope of this is.
It's difficult for me to take this further if all you can say is that you're only responsible, which I accept, for policing on match days. But my questions really relate to the policing of the park, and in particular, the residents. It's a growing community. I'm going to bring you in later, David,
I was only going to say, the security of the park more generally, we can maybe help with, I suppose, not just the policing, but the security arrangements that prevail across the park. I'm happy, obviously, if you want to pursue the line of questioning with Commander Harrington, but if you want, we can, and my colleague Mark Camley, who's here, in terms of how we manage security and safety in the park generally, we can help you.
Mr. Roberts looks after the licensing functions, David, and I'm going to come to you later as well. I'm more interested in the policing aspects of the park as a whole, and particularly the residents, the people who live there. and also, how you work with other agencies. I mean, you talked about the partnership maturing, but obviously I'm a bit frustrated if all you can talk about is the maturity showing itself on match days and not on other occasions.
As I described in relation to this, I'll have to come back and answer if there's further questions about the wider policing of the park on non-match days, then I'm afraid I can't help the committee.
Yeah, but presumably, when you've got such a massive development, I mean, yesterday I was down Barking Riverside, another growing township. You do look at these things in totality, don't you?
Absolutely. In terms of match
days, you should have some awareness of the wider aspects of your football-related operations.
Yes, and that's absolutely part of what we do on a match day, is to make sure we link in with local officers, make sure we're taking account of the disruption.
You keep on talking about match days, but I don't think I can take this any further, Chair, if you feel you can't answer.
We've got an empty chair there, which is the borough commander.
It's not the borough commander. The borough commander is Tony Nash.
Chief Inspector, I should say.
David Moorhead, who I do know.
Is David here? Could he help at all?
He could. He could help in relation to
that. I think David Goldson wants a comment, but given David time to come down, you might like to have some questions on.
Well, I do have a question to you, David, coming up, but suppose I can't take this any further with you, Commander. It's a bit disappointing, but...
I'm happy to deal with those questions outside of the meeting and answer those questions as required.
It's good to have these issues explored in public. That's the whole purpose of student scrutiny exercise.
I understand that.
If I can come to you, David. What do you see as the challenges in keeping the park safe and secure? And how do these challenges change on match days?
I think I'm pleased to say that generally on the park, and we're 2.5 years since the park fully reopened, we've had a really successful relationship in terms of it functioning with large numbers of people, with very low numbers of crime and disorder and issues of safety. We do operate a sort of park safety and security regime. We have a control room on the park, and that is part of how we liaise with all the relevant agencies, including the borough, and of course the police who work with us in that way. In terms of crime and disorder, we've had the numbers month by month vary around sort of 10 or 11 recorded incidents of crime per month. I think obviously again we would want to keep that as low as possible, but they are very low, and I think in any comparative exercise the park has proved itself And when I say the park, I'm including the wider communities such as Westfield and the new housing developments that are coming, have proved themselves safe and very popular environments. And we're bringing now, getting towards 6 million visitors a year through the park. And obviously that's increasing with the football attendance and the other developments that are coming, new employers who are coming in. And yet we are running a regime where people are, I think, enjoying the park, enjoying the experience, and not causing trouble. I think the second half of your question was particularly about match day, where there are particular arrangements in place, which I think are relevant to all of the attendees here. We do, the control room and the park arrangements we have for park, the park generally operate on those days, and there is integration and coordination between the park and the arrangements that are put in place through Linda's team and through the police, and a part of what's reviewed in the safety advisory group that Sheila takes responsibility for. So I think the coordination of events, and again, of course, major events in the stadium and in the park aren't new this year. Those arrangements were used last year when we had 5 Rugby World Cup matches. We've had, obviously, Diamond League Athletics a number of occasions over the last recent years. So those arrangements are pretty well tested and proven on major event days in the stadium, whether that is football or the other events. And of course, now we've hosted our first concerts as well and had even bigger capacity crowds. We've had major events in the stadium. We've had concerts in the Copper Box at the same night as matches in the stadium, or concerts in the stadium. And you know, those crowd management issues and those safety arrangements have proven to work very successfully.
I may come back to you, David. Okay. If we've got turn to you, Peter. Westfield is a large footfall of people, especially on match days. What safety and security issues do you experience when football and other events are taking place in the stadium, and how are these issues mitigated?
Okay, I'm Peter Miller. I'm COO for Westfield. I run Westfield's business here in the UK and Europe. Obviously, one of the key things is the priority for us is the health, safety and security of our customers, the public, our retailers, and also all the other occupants of our estate, including visitors to the hotels and office occupiers, etc. So it's of primary importance that we have safety and security for the success of our investment in Stratford, which is substantial. And all our stakeholders, we've invested over £2 billion in developing our estate there, including the retail and office and hotels, etc. So it's very important to us that safety and security is upheld. You mentioned a huge footfall. We have 47 million people visiting our shopping centre annually. That means about 1 million people a week, just to put it in perspective. About 200,000 on a busy Saturday when the football matches are being played. The shopping centre itself has a capacity of about 35,000 people. And most days, if you've been down there to the shopping centre, you'll see it's rammed full. It's a very busy shopping centre, very successful. And being a catalyst for regeneration in the area, it's fundamentally important that, you know, the 10,000 jobs that are created by the centre are obviously held and sustained for the future. A lot of those people who employed there were long-term unemployed before we developed the estate. So putting all of that in context, the challenges for us are really the fact that in hard egress at the end of the match, a lot of the football spectators obviously have to exit from the stadium and get to the railway hubs. In doing so, they have to cross over our land, the town centre link bridge, and also getting into the Northern Ticket Hall is also going across our land. That requires an interface with our customers and with the general public. And our primary objective, working with other stakeholders here, is to make sure that, as I said, our customers, the general public, as well as the football fans are well looked after, they're safe, secure, and we don't have issues. We're actually at the pinch point of the egress, because if you look at I don't know if you've been down there, but it's a very complex egress. We've had to work very intensively with all the stakeholders to make sure that that safety and security is upheld. And we're working through, it's been a constant review process with all the stakeholders here to make sure that we, you know, we can actually mitigate the risks associated with it. Football fans, I mean, you hear, you know, they're not like the Olympic fan, you know, the Olympic spectators. There are some non-compliant elements in there, and we've got to make sure that there's security as well as crowd management. The bridge itself is a complex crowd management area, because we've actually got to allow for the fans to go across the down Montfitchet, up the stairs, and over the bridge. But we've also got to allow our customers to get into the shopping centre and visit the Olympic Park, because not everyone's watching football. And also we've got to make sure that the customers and visitors to the Olympic Park can actually get out over the town centre link bridge. So it's a very complex management of that. And that's always under constant review, because it's a very big concern to us to make sure that there are no issues on the bridge. Also, obviously, exiting into the Northern Ticket Hall, again, customers have to get out of the Northern Ticket Hall. They have to get into the shopping centre, and vice versa. They have to get out of the shopping centre into the Northern Ticket Hall and get home safely. And when there's a hard egress, and also at times when there's a peak ingress period, we've got to make sure that those interfaces are well managed, and the security and safety of everybody concerned is properly administered and executed. So those are some of the complexities we deal with. I mean, generally, football's obviously got its other challenges, but generally the events that we run about, combined with the other stakeholders here, we run about 40 to 50 crowd-managed events a year in and out of the stadia and other venues that are in the Olympic Park. There's a huge amount of collaboration that goes on with all the stakeholders to make sure that those events are expertly managed, executed, well planned, well organized. Westfield has a long track record of managing huge events. We've probably got a team that's probably the most consistent through the period since the centre opened, since the Olympic Park was launched. In fact, we opened in September 11, so since then, a lot of our team are still intact, so they've had a lot of experience managing big crowds right through the Olympic Games and through all the big events that David and his team have attracted to the park. So we believe we've got a huge amount of experience in working with and the knowledge base and in working with these as part of one of these stakeholders in this team over here. And I call it a team because it has to be a team if we're going to be successful and actually get a stabilized, long-term, sustainable solution to this. Then we have to operate as a team, and we have to be absolutely joined. The communication has to be second to none. Those are some of our challenges. I mean, obviously, for us, it's really important that that we have a commercially robust solution here, that it's sensible in the long term for everybody, and that there are the right resources allocated to this, because everybody's sitting around this table, and some of the key stakeholders not represented here have invested a huge amount, both commercially and individually, in making sure Stratford City's an enormous regeneration success. And I think that's what you've been steering towards. It is a success, and we need the future success to be underpinned by making sure that crowd management and the whole stadium and all the reputation of Stratford City as a location is underpinned. So, we're certainly invested as a company in working intensively to find the right long-term solutions to this. And, that's our mantra.
Thank you, sir. I'll leave it at that.
Okay, I'm going to bring Caroline in, but I think we've got some unanswered questions around the Deputy Chair's posed around the broader policing aspects that we probably will need some answers to, but we can touch upon this. Caroline, did you want to?
I just wanted to ask Peter, have your retailers noticed a drop in footfall when there have been match days, particularly given some of the incidents that have occurred? I would have thought many sort of shoppers might decide actually to avoid going to Westfield on days when there are football matches on.
To date we haven't. It's very hard to measure whether there's been a drop in footfall, because obviously you've got the added footfall that comes in because of the football. So a lot of football fans either come into the shopping centre before the match, or some of them. I mean, after the match, generally there's a hard egress and people want to get home. But some people do, we offer the opportunity for people to actually come back into the shopping centre once the hard egress has taken place. So it's very hard to measure whether there has been an impact. In fact, the footfall at Stratford has been growing dramatically since the opening. And as I said, we're now at 47 million and it's growing positively. Obviously, we're all very concerned, particularly Westfield, that we have a long-term sustainable solution here, and it doesn't detract, because we've got a massive investment. As I said, over $2 billion is invested just in our facility by us, you know, our joint venture partners, Canadian Pension Plan, APG, which is a Dutch pension fund, and Westfield itself. But you've also got the hotel owners, the casino owners, all the retailers, the cinemas. You've got you know, plans now for residential development on our site, office buildings, and then you've got the nearby stakeholders who've invested a lot, like Lendlease and Wimpy and the East Village partners as well, and it's growing. It's a real success story. But the retailers themselves, that we have had comments, it'd be wrong for me not to admit that we haven't had comments from retailers to say that on match days, their conversion, some retailers, their conversion is down on match days. It's interesting. I mean, obviously the restaurants and the pubs and the leisure facilities are up because of the nature of football. But some of the retailers have commented that they are seeing comparable drop in turnover during matches. But, you know, it's hard to actually assign that to the matches themselves. It could be there are a whole lot of factors that can influence that.
It could be, but I think you probably need to be careful, and that's why it's important us having this discussion today, because you could end up with people saying it's a no-go area on certain days. You know, when cycling's on, it might be fine, but people may feel when football's on, actually, I don't want to be in that area at that time because I don't think I'm going to be safe. And that's why I think our discussion today is really timely, to make sure we don't see that loss of people using the facility.
That's why we're all working together so intensively. And it's not just about the retail, it's about everything else that's there. You know, there's a lot being invested in residential, you know, people wanting to live in Stratford, wanting to make it a community and a great place to be, to live, to work and to play. And we want to make sure it's a success. I mean, a lot of people invested a lot of time and money in this, and it's important we have a long-term sustainable solution.
Can I add one point to that? I agree with everything Peter said, and Westfield has been a great success and is a big part of the wider regeneration benefits of the area, and obviously we all want to help sustain and support that success. The arrangements we have around match days, Peter explained some of the challenges, but we do have in place now perfectly sort of satisfactory and working routes that don't go through the shopping centre, that go round, using the roads and around the park into the stations. Obviously, we have a number of stations around the park as well, but Stratford Regional itself has, we have two different routes without going through the shopping centre. So it works fine. As we're all saying, I think there's always looking for how can we improve that further. We have got Chris Allison working with us now in terms of other opportunities, in terms of how we all work, and looking, including at egress and the ways out from the stadium through, if you like, onto the transport system, if there are further improvements. But it is working now. We're not taking shoppers through the shopping centre. As Peter said, there's not taking spectators through the shopping centre. The spectators if they don't want to go into the shopping centre, go straight into the station through the other routes, and therefore, whilst, as Peter said, they touch onto Westfield land on the bridge or on the way into the station, it's not into the shopping centre itself. So shoppers shouldn't feel that pressure.
I mean,
I think one of the points to make from West Ham's point of view is that we are going to be there for the next 98 and a half years. Obviously Westfield are our neighbours. So working together to, I understand Peter wants to protect the commercial interests of Westfield, that's totally legitimate, and our supporters need access. And a lot of these issues have been dealt with in the 106 and the planning permissions and all of the other things that Westfield have to abide to, but we obviously want to work with them. So our supporters who want to make their way to the station can make it as quickly and as effectively as possible, and those that do want to go and enjoy the facilities at Westfield, of which there are many, are able to do that, and it seems to be working okay.
Okay. Caroline's point was a good one, because clearly outcomes that we all want is people to visit and to shop and to live safely, and not to see those images that were seen a few weeks ago and think, I don't want to go there on that day when West Ham are playing, and that clearly is what we want to be able to proof against, and I think that's the work that we want to help you with today. Now, we've got a few questions about the safety advisory group. Peter, I think you're leading on these.
Yes, so thank you, Mr. Chairman. Yep, thank you. Good morning. Yes, sort of technical things really relating to security and safety. Can I start asking you, Sheila, actually, you're here from Borough of Newham. Can you just tell us what your role is?
Yeah, I've effectively got two roles. I'm a strategic enforcement manager, and part of my remit is to deal with the licensing and certification of the stadium, and I also chair the safety advisory group. So one's a regulatory role and one's an advisory role.
Regulatory and advisory, I see, great. Can you sort of shed some light on the actual planning process for us for ensuring security and safety on match days?
Okay. Well, it starts quite early, and prior to the safety certificate being issued, the general safety certificate. That safety certificate does require certain safety arrangements are in place, and the whole ethos of that safety certificate is to ensure public safety. So there are many operational arrangements that need to be in place through the operations manual. The certificate requires stewarding plans, it requires medical plans, it requires fire plans. There's a whole list that I'm quite happy to go through if you want me to go into more detail. But basically, it puts in the arrangements to make sure that safety is adhered to, and that when spectators do enter, that they do so in a safe manner. A lot of it is around evacuation and safe evacuation, and there is a time limit put on that from 8 minutes. So there's detail about the egress routes, the ingress routes, the number of gates, the number of turnstiles. But pivotal to that is the safety management team, and there is... I'm very satisfied with the safety management arrangements that are in place. The safety management team is very experienced, they're very knowledgeable. They make arrangements to put the plans in place, and then after every game there is a review. If there are learnings to be made, the safety management team puts those into place very, very quickly. They are overseen by the safety advisory group, but as a regulator it's important that the safety certificate is complied with, and that's the whole point of that. One of the requirements is that there must be a safety officer, a full-time safety officer, in place at all times during the game. There is a deputy, actually. Yeah. But in terms of the safety certificate, there has to be a safety officer there at all times. Mm. If there is not a safety officer there, then spectators are not allowed to enter into the stadium. So it's quite an absolute requirement. In terms of monitoring, obviously there's their own internal monitoring that happens through the delivery of those safety arrangements. There are pre-opening checks before every single game anyway, so the doors do not open unless everything is in place, which includes messaging, which includes the fire safety plan, which includes the stewards, includes the postings. The safety officer has got ultimate responsibility, but as a regulator, so far we've attended every event that's taking place, be it football or not football. The Sports Ground Safety Authority has also got a role in this, because they issued a licence that allows the spectators in, and they've also monitored every single game that's taking place so far, and every event, in fact.
Yes. Could you explain to me, sorry, because I just simply don't know, with the certificate of safety, how long does that last?
It lasts until something changes. So the current one was issued in August, and the capacity for pitch games is 57,000. But if then there is an application to change that or vary it, then the safety certificate will be reviewed and then has to be reissued. So that's in terms of capacity or any of the arrangements that change in a major way. But it's a dynamic document. If there are small arrangements, then that's fine. They can take place within the existing conditions on that safety certificate. So, for example, as has been mentioned before, there's a risk assessment that takes place before every game that takes into account intelligence and other information. That happens before every game, and that's the provision for that is within the safety certificate. So anything that's been put into place as a result of learning, that's catered for. But if it's something major, if there are new seats put in, if there's any structural work, if there's a greater capacity that's desired, that there's an application made, and then it's incumbent on the safety management team to tell us what the safety arrangements are that are going to be different. There are two issues that are important in terms of capacity. It's called the P factor and the S factor. P stands for physical, really. So that's the physical arrangement. So they are the means of escape, how long it takes people to get out, how many seats there are, they're in the right place, sight lines, lots of detail. Mm-hmm. That will determine the figure for capacity. And then there's also something called the S factor. The S factor is about the safety arrangements, the safety management arrangements, and that includes people really. So stewards, safety management team, those two together should be one. The P factor should be one, which relates to the number of spectators that they're applying to be there, and the S factor should be one, which basically means that everything is satisfactory before people enter into the stadium. If there are concerns, then through the safety advisory group, there's a lot of partners. It's quite a large safety advisory group, as you appreciate. There's a lot of partners involved in this. And then everybody has a voice in that. So if they have concerns, they address those concerns through the chair of the safety advisory group, which is myself, to the operator. And it's the operator's responsibility to come up with solutions, which, as I said, they do that in a proactive way anyway. If there are any further concerns, then they are dealt with in that group.
So overall, I mean, I think you've explained very fully, but overall, you chair the group that is overall responsible for the safety of the stadium.
Just semantically, the safety advisory group is an advisory group, as it said. It's really to advise the local authority on how to administer the safety certificate and to advise the operator on how to comply with the safety certificate. In terms of overall responsibility, we are the regulator, and we regulate as a certifying authority through the safety certificate. So they're slightly different. In effect, it's the same, but in terms of responsibility, I've got to be clear that the safety advisory group is an advisory group.
Okay, great. Thank you. If I could just ask Alan, just with the safety certificate, what does the detail about expectations for safety what is the detail in the certificate?
So Alan Skewis, I'm the director of E20 Stadium LLP, which is a joint venture set up between LLDC and London Borough of Newham to own the stadium over the 98 and a half years that Karen's mentioned already. So we employ LS185, which Linda's the chief executive of, to run the stadium on our behalf, by way of background. So Linda makes the application to Sheila for the safety certificate, and manages all of that for them. Our role is to get the assurance that is being done properly, and Sheila provides that assurance that the certificate has been in place.
So basically, you know, what are the expectations, as it were? I mean, can you just be a little bit more detailed?
I'll answer and then hand over to Lynn. So we expect that the LS185 have a certificate in place for an S factor and P factor, which is safe, works for the whole stadium, and at a capacity which is agreed and in place. What we use as safety advisory group, the second part of that, and we have an active role in that, is to make sure that there are adaptations within that group that mean that we are improving, and any issues that have been raised and learnings from games has been been addressed.
I see.
So, well, I think overall there's something like 31 different conditions that we have to comply with. And Sheila's mentioned some of them. So I think, you know, a really good example, we talked about pre-event checks. So 48 hours before, 24 hours before, my team are ensuring that the PA system, for example, is working so that if we have to evacuate people, they can be evacuated safely. My team are also working with our stewarding providers to make sure that, dependent on the risk assessment and the intelligence, that we've got the right numbers of stewards, the right type of stewards, and we know how we're going to deploy them. We also do a much wider planning piece as well with the club, with Westfield, with TfL, because each match is different. We share intelligence. We obviously look at the plans. Do we need to change anything? Is there anything that came? I mean, for me, it is an iterative process. We are constantly learning. We're constantly, you know, we're not sitting there and thinking, oh, that match was good, you know, tick the box. We're actually looking at it and thinking, right, and what can we actually do better? And I do know that I think that some of you are looking to come and visit us. Mm-hmm. And I think that would be a really good idea, because then we can take you into the control room. We can actually show you the multi-partnerships that are actually there and what the individual roles are and how we work together to deliver that.
So you mentioned that you obviously, you know, as it were, monitor after each match and all the rest of it. Could I just therefore ask you again, what did the safety group, what did it conclude specifically about the recent disorder at the West Ham matches?
I think it's been said, it's a very small minority of ticket holders that seem to be bent on causing disorder. It's not a general reflection of what happens there.
Yeah.
It's unfortunate that it's got a lot of publicity, which in my view as chair of the Safety Advisory Group is unfair. In terms of public safety, there have been learnings and developments, and as I said, it is a dynamic situation and they are assessed after each one. In terms of the actual disorder itself, it is a very, very small number of people that have done that.
Like how many?
I think it's been mentioned already. They're in the possibly 18 arrests. There've been 18 arrests, and then 27, I think, further investigation. I think what's important is to separate the visitor experience and from the actual safety issue. There have been publicised issues about persistent standing, and I think sometimes it can reflect on safety, but it's also about the visitor experience, and I think that has been dealt with quite firmly. Through the Safety Advisory Group, because it is difficult, as has been said, there are families there, there are young people, there are elderly people that might not be able to stand, and it does affect their experience, but that doesn't necessarily mean it impacts on public safety. And the role of the Safety Advisory Group is really to talk about public safety. So although it's regrettable and it should not happen, there are plans in place every time it does happen to deal with it. So the operator has put in different segregation arrangements. There have been response teams that augment the role of the security of the safety stewards. There's an arrangement with the police now that every time it does develop and it does grow. So my answer would really be that I think people have come with that intent.
I'm sorry, my questions have just cleared the gallery. They must be very good.
It was no reflection on the question, I'm sure.
But, could you just be indulged one more question, actually, which is totally off subject, actually, but I'm just interested, because now that you're here, would you be, therefore, looking at and taking great deal of care over possible attacks on, for example, the ground? You know, I'm thinking of the terrorist attacks that have happened in football grounds.
I mean, it has been addressed, obviously, after the Stade de France issue. There was a different searching regime that was instigated, again, and suggested by LS 185. At the moment, it's 100% bag check, and there are people are physically checked as well. They use the wand, and they pat down people for the away fans. It's always something that people are concerned with. I think it's part of the stewards' briefings as well. There's an awful lot of CCTV in there. I think that the stadium are well aware of hostile reconnaissance visits that might take place. There's been some training offered by the Metropolitan Police Service in that regard. So I think it's something that there is an awareness of, and everything that's reasonable is being done to try and stop that.
I think the police obviously have a prime role in this respect. If we can,
Chair, if I can,
BJ had already signalled to come in on this particular point. Do you want to come in on that?
Absolutely. I mean, nationally through National Counterterrorism, we have done some guidance and counterterrorism design advisors who've spoken to every club, including West Ham, to bring that knowledge and experience in to improve the security, hence the increased bag checks. All officers are briefed in terms of the current terrorist threat level and are aware of those issues in the briefing. So it's an integrated plan between the two, and obviously we've got clear emergency plans which are integrated with the stadium to respond to any incident, whether that be terrorist or otherwise, and we continue to monitor the threat to sporting stadia and put a plan in place should that threat increase.
I know it was a bit off subject, but I mean the fact is that with Stratford City and the match and the football match there as well, it's just a pay dirt, isn't it, for a terrorist wanting to actually, you know, sort of, you know, make an attack. It's just a huge target. So,
I mean, just to come, I mean, this is interesting. We wanted to talk about this anyway, which is the point of it, because we didn't want to just concentrate on the arrest and disorder. We wanted to particularly led by the Deputy Chair, to spread the debate to around the Westfield, and because of the large amount of numbers. The understanding on that point, and then it's going to come in, is that the safety advisory group has responsibilities around that as well. We'll be looking at the large numbers coming in on the day, both, but you don't look at that.
Indirectly, not directly. Clearly, that's a police issue.
Right.
The safety advisory role is really to make sure that if there is an incident, then everybody gets out safely. So in terms of that, in terms of
out
the
ground as opposed to the border piece.
Out of the ground, right. To a place of safety or a place of relative
right.
safety, yes.
Right.
So the whole island is subject to the safety certificate. So obviously, as I mentioned before, everybody must be out within 8 minutes. And I think there are all the doors open, would open, there would be PA systems, and they would default to the open position, and everybody could get out very quickly. In terms of stadium design, that's a positive thing about the London Stadium, and everybody can get out very quickly within, and certainly within 8 minutes.
I think if the questions are about the area, which I think you're asking, the Stratford area and the stadium and the interface, and how, if there was such a threat, that would be managed and coordinated. Would it be okay if I brought Mark Camley in, who does coordinate all this for us with the partners across the area? Because we do have coordinated plans, we rehearse, we activate, and that's something that Mark leads on, which is why I wanted him to be here.
Thank you. Mark Camley, I'm the Exec Director for Park Operations and Venues across the park and the wider LLDC estate. We take an overarching role on business as usual. Operation safety and work closely with all the partners during match day events. So we have a control room where the partners join us for what's happening in terms of egress and ingress on the park and controlling that. Particularly in relation to counter-terrorism, we have hostile vehicle mitigation measures across the park, which include the parklands and each of the venues, including the stadium. To make sure that we can protect against a nice type attack. We have extensive CCTV and partnership agreements in place with the police and work closely with them on any intelligence that they might have. We also, as David indicated, exercise regularly both on desktops which look at non-event days and event days, and we would do them on event days, and it's with all the partners. And we've done them at gold level, silver level, and ensured that in terms of command and control communications, that there is clarity about if there was an incident, who would take primacy and how that would be managed through. That includes each of the blue light services, includes Transport for London, includes Westfield in those plans as well. The local authority are also involved as our LS 185 when we have an event day.
You want to come in?
Yeah, I wasn't going to come in, but it does beg the question, listening to you all as we come in, between, I get it, a mature partnership, people working together for sustainable solutions to the issues, but I really really, I don't get any feeling of some of the pre-planning and pre-discussions. Well, on the counter-terrorism issues, how did we get into a situation where Airwave wasn't, given this is an iconic stadium, a target for terrorism, and somehow it fell through the cracks, because that's what it appears with the information given. Who should we hold to account for this? Are you all jointly responsible for not getting adequate emergency communication to a stadium at the very beginning before we do these things? What went wrong on that bit? Just following up on Peter, issue, because it does seem to me one of the failures at the moment, because as a user and observing some of these issues, it's not rocket science to have avoided some of, I think, the headlines that we've had and some of the issues. I think a bit more thought in the process of different elements could have avoided some of these problems. But on the back of the terrorism one, how have we got into a situation where we have not got a proper emergency policing issues inside the ground on a stadium that has, from the public's point of view, considerable amount of investment that's gone into it? This was like, where was this on the list of priorities of people looking after the safety of the users of the ground, or, in dealing with those issues? Who's at fault?
If I kick off in terms of the broad question, the stadium had Airwave in it for the 2012 games. It's not that it hasn't been overlooked, but the stadium, as you know, has been substantially transformed in the period since 2012. It's effectively been redeveloped from the temporary stadium, or the demountable stadium that was built to host the games, now into the permanent multi-use venue that we know now, where we can host both West Ham's long-term arrangement as our sort of anchor tenant and bring in concerts and the other events, and it is a completely different structure. So Airwave was installed. We have got operational arrangements now in place so that the police can deploy using sort of tactical arrangements so that they are covered for the communication they need. And Commander Harrington, I'm sure, will come in on this. And we have got agreement in place that it will be fully operational from February. So I don't think there is any major omission that's occurred. Until the transformation was complete, it wasn't really possible to precisely configure the way the system's going to work. But I mean, there's a technical detail to that the police would be better commenting on. But the police have been able to deploy when they've needed to deploy into the stadium, and they have done, and they did before even the tactical arrangement we've got in place now was in place. So I don't think there's some major omission that you you need to worry about that goes into sort of the counter-terrorism risks. But probably Commander Harrington should pick up on that.
I mean, first and foremost, there is no reason, with the absence of the full in-building solution, the police cannot deploy inside the stadium. And indeed, where we've been called to for crime and disorder, we have done, and that has been seen. If there was a terrorist incident, we would deploy into that stadium. The issue that comes around having and going forward from this point, there is a tactical solution which allows, as you've heard, the deployment of officers in a special policing service arrangement for preventative policing. That allows that, and from February going forward, Linda and myself are overseeing the implementation of that with Airwave, and that will be in a full in-building solution in operation. And so it hasn't affected the way we've policed the stadium, and it hasn't affected the ability for the police to respond. There are lots of places where there is no Airwave coverage where we deploy to in terms of terrorist incidents.
So, Chair, it does lead to a question. Why wasn't that rebutted? If you're giving me assurance, which you're trying to do, I remain unreassured, that there was a temporary solution in place from all these matches, or just when the trouble started to occur? That's the bit. And I don't believe everything I read in the press, but actually, I think I do recall police officers giving one of the reasons, police officer quotes, Met quotes, one of the reasons why they found it difficult is because they never had a system to communicate with each other. What is the true story then? So you have a temporary system, is that true, right from the beginning, that allowed you to do your policing operations from the very beginning of matches taking place in that stadium? And all along, in February, we were going to have the fully fit for purpose service in terms of this important element. I don't understand why that's the case still. You've not reassured me at all.
Airwave guarantee coverage for officers outside of buildings. That's part of the contract that they do for us as the police service nationally and the Metropolitan Police Service. There is coverage inside the stadium, and we can deploy into that stadium in order to deal with issues. And the issue is it's not guaranteed by Airwave. If we are going to put officers into the stadium under a special policing service agreement, that is, which is asked for by the stadium, which is a discretionary service that the Chief Constable can offer, then we've got to ensure that we, under health and safety legislation, that we guarantee the coverage. And that's why we, and that's why we've insisted and asked, and indeed have been provided with, in the interim, a tactical solution, which allows us to do that, and in the long term, this full in-building solution
so
that will be in place.
So when did you insist on that then? What's final, the timeline?
Well, in terms of the changes to the stadium, Airwave, the final requirement for what was required to do this in-building solution was only available from Airwave on the 3rd of August. From that point, London Stadium 185 and ourselves, London Stadium 185 have funded that, and we have then pushed the installation of that at the quickest possible timelines. Be assured that we are holding Airwave to account to make sure that that is delivered as quickly as is feasible. And I don't have the technical knowledge to describe, but it is a significant investment. And as I said, I come back to the point, is there has never been the inability for police to deploy inside the stadium, whether in terms of a terrorist incident or indeed in terms of disorder, and we have done. I would caveat all of this to say the aim for policing is not to have officers inside a stadium, because it's a private event. There's very good stewarding to do that. These officers come from boroughs, and they are taken from other parts of policing London to do this. So we will only deploy them there where we're requested to, and where the operational need is there.
Or where you have specific intelligence that it might kick off, presumably. You could insist that actually on your intelligence and your grading system earlier on, as in the Chelsea game, I understand, you had specific intelligence both from Chelsea and West Ham that there were issues. You could have insisted of deployment of officers inside the stadium much earlier. Is that true?
That there was specific intelligence at the Chelsea game. We would always seek to prevent that. The operational plan in that case was to, one, identify those people who might cause problems. It was to identify them outside the ground, which we did. We brought some of those people to the ground. We used legislation to disperse a group of those, and we sent them away from the ground, ticket holders who we feared would commit crime and antisocial behaviour. So we used that legislation to send them away. And we done everything to reduce that disorder, and then working with the club inside.
In your wider prevent role then, do you think you should maybe on occasions be a bit more insistent with the people that you're dealing with about some of the threat that you might be facing with, and say, actually, normally we'd have a discussion about this, and it is your event, but actually we're going to insist that we want X, Y, Z to happen on this occasion. Do you feel that on that prevent role, that maybe the police should be a bit more insistent with the people you're dealing with?
I think that we are insistent where we need to be. We've got a good partnership which allows us to reduce those. Must stress, this is a small minority of people out of the 56,000 people that are attending the London Stadium. We have clear plans around dealing with those and identifying those. We are satisfied that the stadium and the London Stadium 185 have got clear arrangements overseen by the Safety Advisory Group, as you've heard. And I am quite certain that if I had the need where I wasn't confident in those, that I could come to the partnership or address the Safety Advisory Group in order to make those changes, and they would listen to those. In terms of the Chelsea game, it was a high-profile, high-risk game. We identified it as such. We had an extensive policing operation. I think you've seen the numbers of the officers deployed. There was an extensive stewarding and security operation, which, let's be honest, with the, was effective. There was a small minority who were unacceptable and inappropriate behaviour, which the club are dealing with in terms of club bans with the stadium, that we are investigating and seeking bans in the courts to prosecute people. So now I'm very confident that if I asked, that would be listened to. I'm very confident the plans we've had so far have been effective. Different challenges at every game as things develop, and I think the outcome, I'll come back to the Stoke game, all of that collaborated learning, all of that knowledge that has shown that now we are in a place where we identify threats, and that was the Stoke game, that our tactics together, police, stadium and the club, are effective in preventing crime and disorder and doing all the things we want, which is to make it a safe place and a place where people experience it and feel they can come to safely.
Thank you.
Are we going to have some questions a little bit later about specifically about policing and stewarding? But the point that we're reflecting upon is that this stadium particularly seems to have a need for police, whereas other stadia in London at the moment, during football matches, has virtually nil police requirements in the main. But we're getting on to that in a minute. We're going to ask some questions about banning of fans from Florence. One last question for me around the safety certificate and that process. Because uniquely this stadium is a number of partners, all of which, many of which are here, unlike other football stadia that always have to apply for a safety certificate, the applicant in that case would be potentially the owner of the stadium, which in most cases would be the football club. They would be the prime responsibility around that. Here it's more confused, conflated.
The owners of the stadium actually delegate that responsibility to me through my safety officer. Right.
So the question begs, and it's what I call the kind of Notting Hill question, is if, God forbid, something bad happened, who has the prime responsibility in the stadium, a legal responsibility for safety?
Well, my safety officer is responsible for that on the match day events. So he is the one who controls all the operations, who would make the decisions if, for example, there needed to be an evacuation. And as I said, and it would be really good if you come to see the control room.
We are coming along. No, that's the operational piece. I'm just saying if it's a simple, there may not be a simple answer, but if something particularly bad happened, David, you're going to leap in on this, no doubt. If something particularly bad happened, God forbid, we get loads of reassurance here, so let me just say that. But if something, just from a legal point, if something bad happened within the ground, in the stadium, who would be at the end of a legal process?
E20 Stadium, owner stadium, we have in our contract with LS185, LS185 responsible for that and getting the safety.
So you're the owner.
Owner stadium, but we have a contract with LS185. They have the responsibility for the safety and control of that
stadium. That's what I wanted to understand. Sorry, Florence, thank you.
We touched on fans and the number of arrests earlier on. So of the 18, if I'm correct in understanding, 9 of them were West Ham supporters. So to both Linda, BJ and definitely you, Karen, in terms of those fans, how many of them have been banned from attending matches for this season and how many have received lifetime bans?
I'll deal with the legal issues around that. There is, at this stage, none of the people arrested this year have so far been given bans. There's two sorts of bans. There's bans on intelligence and bans on conviction. So until we get convictions, we can't ask the court for those bans. We will do. There are two bans underway from arrests from West Ham this year, and I don't know the exact progress of those. So as we convict people of criminal offences, we will, and the court are obliged to consider banning orders under Section 14A, where we get intelligence that we think meets the threshold under 14B, we will go for the civil injunction type of bans. If you look at, and we're quite good in relation to that, we've got 282 bans, I'm just looking for my exact numbers, in relation to that, and in terms of, if you bear with me, there's, so apologies, 302 bans across all football support, or people who call themselves football supporters in London. West Ham have 38 currently, Millwall 51, Chelsea 59 and Tottenham 29 to give some comparison. As I say, we will seek bans on everyone who's convicted, and we will seek bans where they meet the threshold for the civil injunction type ban based upon intelligence. That is a process that takes a number of weeks around that. Separate to that, of course, the club, and I'm sure Karen will.
The club ban supporters. Karen, do you want to?
Yes, anyone who's identified as causing any form of trouble is identified through their ticket purchasing and banned. We work in conjunction with LS185 because we can ban them from football and LS185 have to ban them from the stadium. So it's a joint process. It's not always straightforward identifying people because if they are in an area causing trouble, you have to follow them back through the CCTV to their seat to identify them in their seat, which gives you the name and address and the details of who they are. But it's because the stadium has such excellent CCTV that 71 people have been identified and banned.
So how are those bans being enforced, and how successful would you say they've been?
Well, they're banned from the stadium and from West Ham matches. Their details are issued. They are issued with the ban. Some have appealed. Some have actually successfully appealed, where it's been a case of mistaken identity. And they are circulated to other football clubs, and that's the process of the ban.
Effectively, their season tickets and membership cards are revoked, so they wouldn't be able to work then at the turnstile.
And if I can, in terms of those legal bans, the court's ban, we've got a dedicated football liaison officer, an officer called Andy Sheldon, who works dedicated to West Ham. We have dedicated teams of intelligence officers. They know the people who are on these bans from the various clubs. The officers deployed a brief as to who they are. We attach specific conditions, not only to deal with you can't go to the match, but also where we can to say not within 2 miles of a Premiership match, not within a borough where a Premiership match is taking place. And we actively monitor and look for those people, and when we see them we make arrests. And of course that extends to travel abroad for international games, where we have ports monitoring operations to make sure they don't. So far, as far as I'm aware, there have been no breaches of the legal bans for those that have been issued to people who are affiliating themselves with West Ham. So it's highly effective, and they don't come to the games, and we can control them away from the games as well.
That's reassuring. Obviously, this isn't an issue that's isolated to West Ham, but do you think there's more that the club could do in terms of targeting those regular persistent offenders who are seeking to undermine the club's name?
Well, those who have been identified, or those who can be identified, have been identified and have been banned. That's within our power to do, and we work very closely with both the police and LS185 to physically go and identify them, and have a big team of people whose job it is to watch the CCTV. We are also constantly communicating with our supporters about what's important in terms of stadium behaviour. But I have to really, really point out that the majority of West Ham supporters are passionate and well-behaved. We are talking about a really small minority, which we've worked very hard to identify and ban, and that has been very successful.
Okay, thank you.
I've got a few questions now, I think, around the stewarding, segregation, logistics, colour.
Yes, I want to pick up on the logistics. Perhaps I could start with, perhaps I'm finding it incredibly confusing this morning, understanding how it all runs. I thought LLDC was in charge of everything out there, and it turns out you've got two other organisations I don't think I knew existed until I had my briefing. To Alan, Linda and BJ, what is it that's so different about the London Stadium? I still think of it as the Olympic Stadium, the London Stadium, compared to other stadia, and why is it posing perhaps a greater risk to safety and security? Linda,
well, I'll start and I can answer from a policing perspective. It's a new stadium. It's newly used for football, and again, you've got this minority of people are exploiting that in terms of exploring it and in terms of the vulnerabilities of any new place. The complexity of the wider footprint is unique. The multiple entry points, and look at the different tube stations, the different transport network from the two rail stations, Pudding Mill Lane, the DLR, all of those are things that spectators are learning, and the norms of, if you go to where the Berlin ground, people knew which way they go, they knew which way they parked their car, they knew which pubs or club, pubs or restaurants they went to, they knew which way they walked up. So they're learning those things, so those are changing. And of course, for us, that means that those people intent on disorder, they creatures of habit, and we would know where the flashpoints and where the issues were, so we could police those quite easily. We're learning those because they're learning those, and that's, as I say, about that learning together around that. There is the issue of migration around the stadium is an issue, because those people on tent, and I think the club and 185 will talk about how they're dealing with that. If you are intent on disorder, you can move around the stadium, and I'll leave them deal with what they're doing and the useful work they're doing to control that. Things like the actual Olympic Park itself, it is a wide open expanse. Most stadia in London, there are natural segregation by streets, by furniture, by roads, by cars. Here you have multiple points of entry, And in policing terms, very difficult to segregate. And that's why you'll see larger numbers of police deployments this year, particularly at Chelsea, not to deal with the disorder, but almost to allow us to segregate and prevent the disorder because there's not these natural barriers. And another element, I think, around it is unique. It is a novelty to come to the London Stadium. And I think that is attracting people who perhaps wouldn't have come to the Bullying Ground and people who are intent on disorder. And that is a real factor. And we're having to contend with that with all these other issues. So in policing terms, those are the things I think that make it a new challenge. What I would say is we are learning those challenges. We are learning more each time and allowing to adapt our policing tactics to challenge those and identify those, that, you know, which pubs that different risk, you know, risky groups of supporters are starting to use. What that allows us to do then is to use other legislation, licensing legislation, to put controls around those pubs, to which is what we do normally. But until those norms of behaviour have been set out by the fans attending all these people, we have to, once they've established what they're going to do, then we can understand how we police and react to those threats and prevent the issues.
Caroline, just in relation to the broader responsibility you referred to that we have, I mean, obviously, as Commander Harrington said, most of those challenges relate to it being new. And we do start with, you know, the context of this is we're 11 matches into a 99-year relationship. I think those challenges do exist, but things have already got better, and we've got, you know, and they're all not only can be addressed, but are being addressed and have made improvements already. So I think that's the context we'd want to see it in.
I want to look at, in terms of logistics and layout, what is so different? Commander Harrington has said it's partly it's new, it's multiple entry points, it's transport. What other things, as you manage the stadium itself, you're the chief exec, what is it that you think is so different compared to others?
I think Commander Harrington mentioned about the free movement, so it's easier for people to get round the stadium. So one of the things we've actually started to introduce now is much more hard checking of tickets, so making sure people are actually going to the right seats and actually challenging them if they are not. We've also done a big review, and it's been very much a joint partnership effort with the club, with the police, with local authority, looking actually at the segregation, because the segregation plans were designed, they were passed, everybody felt that they were fit for purpose, but obviously there was one breach at the Watford game. So we obviously reviewed all those plans. They've the actual segregation areas have been extended. We've created a sterile area, so those away supporters who are higher up the stadium can't then throw things down on other supporters below them. And we've also created a dedicated segregation route outside of the stadium from when the away supporters leave the stadium and actually come out to the exit. We've now got a dedicated segregation report there. And again, I mean, all of that has been refined, tested. I think the really good challenge for us, Caroline, was at the Stoke game, because, you know, there was quite a lot of intelligence around there, and it passed off without incident, and there were there was no issues around segregation then at all.
I'll get into the segregation in more detail in a minute. Maybe Alan, you might be able to help here. Is part of the issue that actually the stadium was originally designed for athletics, that the design of it is causing problems? We've reported that there's some issues, that it's an all-seated stadium, but some West Ham fans stand in the game and that causes tension. Also that away fans have been asked to file in through a narrow entrance with only 8 turnstiles, and there were delays and frayed tempers and people were concerned about crush. Is it just that actually the how this stadium was designed is causing some of these issues?
So the stadium is a multi-purpose stadium. It is designed to host athletics, football, concerts, a whole series of events. But a lot of the work has gone on since 2012 to transform it.
It wasn't really designed for football, that's the point, isn't it?
It's designed as a multi-purpose stadium. But a lot of the work that's gone on since 2012, when it was designed for the games itself, has to transform it so it is able to hold football matches in a safe, suitable manner. I think, as people have alluded to on the panel, we've definitely gone through some areas of learning about how you manage football crowds at different games. So I'd go back to the game against Domžale or the Juventus game at the start. The free flow around the stadium worked absolutely perfectly, really well, really added to that event for the supporters. And we're dealing with the 56,900 and whatever supporters who were there to enjoy it and enjoy it in that type of stadium. But the measures which Linda's alluded to, putting extra segregation in, managing away supporters in and out of the stadium, are things which we've learned and have put in place to ensure the safety of the stadium. So I believe the stadium works as a multi-purpose stadium, it works as a football stadium. The measures which we put in place have added to that and have reflected the learnings we've had over the last three or four months. I am absolutely confident that it's a suitable stadium that is safe and can host fantastic games for West Ham at 57,000, and our aspiration is even to go higher than that in time in terms of the capacity of the venue.
I think there's one point I should add as well, that the stadium itself has been designated a UEFA Category 4 status, which is the highest possible status a football stadium can be granted, which means that, for example, it can host a Champions League final. So in terms of its suitability for football, it absolutely is suitable.
So just getting these logistics right, and as you say, you know, it's very different if you're going to a pop concert, people happily wander around, but actually if you've got different fans, you might want to segregate. So let's move into the segregation bit. You talked about more hard checking as you go round. Do you think that that actually has the problems with segregation, and you've changed what you do now, have been part of the problem for fans clashing at the earlier matches?
So we very quickly after the initial games where in the Premier League where there were 3,000 away supporters in the ground. Very quickly, as a collectively between West Ham and ourselves, increased the segregation lines in the upper and lower tiers to increase the distance between supporters and put additional stewards into those areas. We were literally standing in the areas, and West Ham's safety officer and advisors were providing that advice and changed that. That has made the segregation of supporters, away and home supporters in those areas, transform that in terms of the risks to any games. Definitely a good example of very quick response to an issue that was identified in those early games, and definitely helped to manage the risks when we came to the highest risk game we've had, the Chelsea game, in late October.
Can I understand in terms of the seating, because we have been told that it had been previously been little formal segregation between rival fans. Basically, it was achieved by stewards physically standing between the crowds and by leaving some areas of seating empty. What more are you doing on that now?
There was a physical difference, which is fenced, which is then has stewards
fenced
between them, which is standard within other games at Emirates Stadium. That's the way it works.
This is an education.
The addition, which was quickly put in, was to take 7 to 10 rows of seats in addition to that fence and cover them.
Right,
so there were no supporters in those areas, and that creates a sterile area between supporters, which first of all means it's more difficult for them to get close to each other, and secondly means there is a significant distance there between them. That was further extended more recently, just to provide that safety first approach, and that
the club moved
some supporters
to help you. All football clubs have segregation of one form or the other. It's either physical, in terms of a physical barrier, which we have, seatings which are kept empty, which we have, or people, and that could be stewards or police or a mixture of both, and that's the same for every football club in the country.
You've increased it since your early games to make sure that you feel you've got increased segregation.
Absolutely. So what you'll see in the stadium on Saturday, if you watch on television, is different, and it's an expanded solution to what you'd have seen in the first Premier League games.
Okay, and then just talk me through, now this might be David or and Peter, talk me through outside of the stadium how you're segregating fans to the transport links, to the restaurants and bars of Westfield, how you're managing that.
Well, I think actually the segregation immediately coming out of the stadium, it is the responsibility does sit with LS185. Well, it's not confusing. LS185 have, as Linda said, the full operational and safety responsibility for fans inside the stadium and on their egress through to the,
to
the station.
Okay, so Linda, it's all down to you.
There is a separate turnstile which away supporters go in and exit out of. There are now physical barriers when they come out of the stadium that takes them out down to the edge of the footprint of the stadium. I also have a dedicated team of experienced, what we call egress stewards, so people who are very experienced in moving large numbers of crowds safely across the park, and that is what they do. And there are various, what I would call stop points, so if crowds are starting to build up in a certain way, they can actually stop the crowds, and we call it pulsing, so that they can control the flow of the crowds going through the park and along Montfichet Road until we get to the transport hub.
But at every football ground, inevitably, crowds come out, and at some point, you don't segregate them forever, people merge, and you say you don't go to football, you went. But there was always a point at which, obviously, that operation comes to an end and people merge. And we do, I think, go further probably in here in the sense we've got arrangements through the park. But it's part of, you know, they become members of the public who are going about their daily business at a point beyond the stadium. And the police, I think, would confirm, you know, that's normal. I don't think what we're doing is significantly different. It's obviously a different landscape, but the nature of the operation is how it works at other clubs around London and the country.
And I think what's also quite critical is that at half time, my safety officer chairs a briefing where the match day commander, the police match day commander will be present, and other police colleagues, and they actually just review what's happened in the match so far. Are they happy with the egress plans that we've already documented? Does there need to be any changes? Do the police need to have anybody deployed or not? And that is done on a match-by-match basis and works really well as well.
And that's an important point. We will adjust our deployments post the match to support that that segregation immediately outside the turnstiles, and also to any known risk. Again, back to this risk assessment element at half-time, if we think there's going to be a particular problem, either on intelligence or the way we think people have come to the game, we'll adjust the police deployments to put them in a place where they can best, one, prevent, and two, respond to any incidents that develop on as people exit.
Thank you.
Well, I'm pleased about the sterile areas because clearly that's the norm in football grounds where you'd have a bank of seating, 10, 15, 20 rows covered over. And clearly, you didn't have that for the Chelsea game because you just had a line of stewards.
We did have it.
Yeah, well, somehow a lot of these people managed to get within, and I won't say the word, what they were shouting at each other.
I think it does appear that way, but I think that's the way the camera angle. The photograph was taken, but they never actually came together anywhere in the ground. There was never any breach, whether that be in the bowl, on the concourses, or anywhere.
It appeared that there was just a line of stewards.
That's not correct. The sterile area, as it's been described, was in place for that game.
Yeah, well, it should have been a sterile area with about 20 rows of seats, frankly. But anyway, Andrew, you
probably remember the photograph of the Chelsea supporter who's breached the netting and stood on the netting.
That's about as near as they got to each other.
Yes.
Oh, fair enough. Andrew.
Okay, well, I suppose nothing new in sports violence because they had it in Constantinople in Byzantine times between the Greens and the Blues. And while we're on Byzantium, I want to try and untangle a bit the relationship between the Byzantine arrangements between your three different organisations. One thing I would like to try and establish, first of all, from Alan, is do you pay Linda to do the job for you, or does Linda pay you for the privilege of doing it?
So the way our contract is set up is that we pay a number of costs to Linda for her to run the stadium on our behalf and take all the responsibilities taken. Linda is, over the time of the contract, that's a long-term contract, going to provide me with more money back from that to make it into a net profit for E20.
Right, okay. So... when you send a bill, and I'll come on to this in a bit more detail, BJ, you send the bill to Linda, yeah? Linda pays the bill. Do you pass the bill on to Alan?
It's part of our fixed costs budget, so we have an allowance for that, and we would pay that out of the fixed cost budget.
Okay, I think it would be helpful if we could see the contract between E20 and ES185. Can we see that?
It's It's been released, hasn't it?
Yes. Well, it's been released.
I think we've, I think, I can't remember exactly when, but I believe we released it under FOI previously.
Yeah.
But we can...
But if not, can we see it? Yes? Is that a yes?
As ever, we'll need to look at it in the normal way under the FOI requirements around what if there's any elements there can't be. But broadly, of course, if we need to release an agreement and you're asked...
We don't want to have to FOI.
No. I'm not saying you need to register an FOI with us, but in the same way that there are elements that... I mean, there are some elements about safety that don't get released and commercially that we would...
Well, you know, I mean, are you going to let us see it or not?
I'm saying I think it can be released. We'll... subject only to any points that would normally, if it was an FOI, not be releasable under statutory exemptions, but subject to that, yes.
Right. And how long is that going to take?
We can do that immediately from today. Yeah. We'll go back, do the check today if required.
I'll set it up immediately.
Give it to the committee.
Okay. Yep. Right. So can I go on to questions about the stewarding? Now, stewarding is supposed to be governed by the statement of intent set out in the authorised policing practice from the College of Policing document, and we've already established there isn't such a document. Mm. And the duties of the stewards are set out in the College of Policing document, which cross refers to the statement of intent. So I want to probe this a little bit, obviously, without having the benchmark of that document, and I'm rather surprised it doesn't exist, because the College of Policing say the document should be reviewed, updated and signed by the club and the force on an annual basis. So perhaps you let us know in due course whether that is ever going to appear. But if we can go on to the issue of stewarding, what's the safety advisory group, I think it's probably a question for Sheila, said about stewarding arrangements' effectiveness so far?
Okay. Can I just go back on the first point that you made, that there may not be a signed off statement of intent, but there is certainly a stewarding plan. Because that's one of the requirements of the safety certificate. And obviously the stewarding plan details the roles of those stewards. There's a detailed stewarding plan before each game that details the postings of those stewards and the different roles. There are fire stewards, there are safety stewards. So there is detail of that, although it might not be in the place that you expect it to be.
Okay, so does that stewarding plan comply with all the requirements of the College of Policing document?
I'm not aware of all the detail of the College of Policing document, but in terms of the safety certificate, it does comply with the requirements of the safety certificate. But as I said, it's a dynamic arrangement and it may change.
Might be worthwhile you cross-checking with the College of Policing document to make sure it does. It's easy enough to find. It's on the internet.
I can do that. Yeah. But there are two requirements then, and it is complied with in terms of the general safety certificate. So it does comply with that. In terms of the stewarding, obviously the numbers have been increased as learnings have taken place. I think that there was an issue with familiarisation of the stadium because it is new and the arrangements within there don't reflect from the bowling ground for those stewards that came along, and there are stewards who are new to that site. So in terms of the stewards, there are more than there used to be. There's never been an issue with the safety critical control points in terms of the stewarding. The general stewards are gaining in confidence and the learning. In the briefings that take place, there are different tiers of briefings that take place before every single game. So the supervisors are briefed, and then each individual steward is briefed by their supervisors, and there are level managers above that. So there's a lot of detail and tactical detail that's delivered to the stewards on a match-by-match basis. So they are getting better. The stewards themselves are really involved in taking spectators to their seats, in safety arrangements in case there is an evacuation. There are also teams of response teams, which are more to do with dealing with disorder. They're all Security Industry Authority authorised, and they are really separate from the stewards. And they work together increasingly better. I think that they've given more confidence to the stewards as well. So it is it's certainly an improving situation. The stewards are more familiar with which area is which in the stadium, which exit is which. The new arrangements of segregation, they're aware of that. So generally speaking, it's an improving situation.
Okay. You touched on my next question, which is whether any of the stewards that you presently have had moved from the Berlin ground. And I think you said some of them had.
My understanding is each person was offered the opportunity to do so.
Right. So next question is, how many moved over?
I don't know the number.
So I think the general everybody who worked at the Berlin ground who was employed as a steward there was offered a role.
But some may have moved and some may not.
I understand. So I'm just going to say.
Question number one is how many moved? If you don't know, you can tell us.
About half.
And how many is that?
I think about 300.
About 300. Hmm. And how many stewards altogether do you deploy?
1,100.
Yeah, 1,100.
For the recent game. Yeah. For every game, okay. And of those stewards who were at the Berlin ground, fine, and you've got presumably the other 800, is it? Yeah. And are they new to football?
Some are and some aren't. I mean, I think, you know, as you would expect, if you go to a team that side, on the plus side, it's provided some new opportunities for local people to get new jobs, and I think that's fantastic. And that's certainly one of the things that we're looking to aspire for, particularly from a legacy point of view. We have other stewards, and as you can imagine, you know, for anyone who's managed 1,100 people, you have real different spheres within that. We've got other stewards there who've worked regularly at other football matches. So, for example, I honestly don't know about the policing document you mentioned, but what we look at is the green guide and what the safety at sports ground says, what is required for our stewards. So, for example, if we take a new steward on and they need training, then obviously we would look to buddy them up with an experienced steward, whether that be an ex-Berlin steward or okay, say
well,
somebody
well, that's my next question, is what training do stewards receive?
So all of our safety stewards either have to have an MVQ2 in spectator safety, or they have to be working towards that. And in order to work towards that, there is a staged process for that. So, as you would expect, they need to have a detailed induction so that they are familiar with the stadium. They know things like, you know, what the warning codes are, where the exit doors are, what they do in an emergency. They also get a briefing document, and they are buddied up with an experienced steward. And that happens, the guidance is that should happen for 4 games. Obviously, if somebody's not so good, you would look at continuing that longer. And then they have to put together a portfolio of evidence, which is assessed by a qualified assessor. But obviously we also supplement that. So at every single football match, there is a cascade briefing system, which starts at the top with my senior managers and all the senior stewards and level managers, includes Chief Operating Officer from West Ham as well. And then they take those messages down and cascade. And a lot of it will stay the same, but if there's any particular things that we've got to do, so if we're changing the search regimes, then that's what they will do. And then we also have, as Sheila was saying, I mean, we have 6 different types of sort of stewards ranging up to the level manager. They will all have different types of qualifications from MVQ2 to MVQ3 or 4. Some of them will have the SIA certificates as well.
Okay, so, for example, do your stewards all know the ground regulations?
Do they all know the ground regulations?
Yes.
So as part of their induction, they will be familiarised with what the guidance is, what is expected of them in their role, and the various responsibilities that they've actually got.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Do you think there's any more that West Ham could do to support the stewarding?
West Ham were very helpful to us at the beginning of the season in that they arranged for my head of safety and security to go over to about 6 of their games to actually meet all of the stewards who were there and to provide them with, because I think there was a lot of myths going around that they weren't going to be paid as much and this sort of thing. We were able to put a stop to that. Their chief operating officer now attends all of our senior stewards briefing. And I think that's really good for showing that we're working together in a joined-up partnership approach and encouraging that. And I think, you know, where any of us see good examples of stewarding, we make sure that that's passed on, goes up the chain to their managers, so they get a sort of a thank you and a well done.
And what's your turnover of stewards?
It's very difficult to answer that because these are not 1,100 dedicated stewards to our event. You know, so 1 week they'll be working with me, the next week they might be at Tottenham, the week after they might be at Wembley.
So it's like 0 hours contracts, is it?
Sorry?
Are they on 0 hours contracts?
Well, all of our stewards are provided through a stewarding provider. So obviously people have the options to work when they want to work.
Okay. And do they get paid the London Living Wage?
No, they don't. Not at all categories. They don't at the safety, at the basic steward level. We are working, because it's one of the things that we recognise about looking at being competitive, and as you'll appreciate, the stewards are employed at other venues across London. It's not just at the London Stadium. But certainly our senior stewards are paid that, our level managers, hospitality stewards, and we also give them a meal as well.
Doesn't that embarrass you, Karen, that your stewards aren't paid the London Living Wage when you're paying footballers £60,000 a week?
We pay all of our staff the London Living Wage, and we were the first club to do so and have been doing so since 2015. We can't engage with other partners and enforce them to do that. Yes, we'd like it to be done, but it's not part of our authority to insist it is done.
But do you think morally it's your responsibility?
Well, it's a hypothetical question because it's not my responsibility. The stewards who worked, anyone who worked for us at the bowling ground, who works for us anywhere, has been earning the equivalent of the London Living Wage since 2015.
Well, I'm pleased to hear that your direct employees are, but one of the problems we found throughout London is this particular problem where people pass the buck and say, it's nothing to do with me, it's
but
a contractor.
It's not a case of passing the buck.
Well, it seems that way to me.
I can only pay the people I employ. I can't pay the people I don't employ.
Well, it seems that way to me. Anyway, let's move on to some questions for BJ on policing. Do you think if you had more police inside the stadium, it would help prevent further disorder?
The point I would say is that it's a small minority of people who are causing that problem inside the stadium. And I'm absolutely confident with the arrangements that are inside are preventing, and we saw that at the Stoke game, which preventing disorder inside the grounds. And the arrangements and the risk assessment we make before that have contributed to that. Every cop we put inside the stadium comes from a neighbourhood somewhere, comes from part of London Borough. So it is our strategy that it's private premises, and quite rightly, and they are not shying away from that responsibility. London Stadium 185 are absolutely taking that. So we will try and minimise the number of officers in the stadium all the time. It's not our role to police private premises. We wouldn't put cops next to a dance floor if we thought there was going to be a fight in a disco. Okay. However, where we are required to go inside, we will and have done. Where we're requested and where we're able to, we will put officers inside if that's the appropriate risk assessment. And again, as we've done for the Stoke game, we'll be doing for the match on Saturday, we will require payment in the areas we can for that special policing services.
Okay, so I understand that the estimated police officer costs, excluding overtime, for West Ham fixtures so far at London Stadium this year since the 4th of August, up until the 5th of November, is £426,170, correct?
Yeah, I'd say it's a little bit higher than that, in fact, in terms of the total policing costs for West Ham, for those fixtures this year.
Yeah, okay. And you've billed West Ham for about 10%, not West Ham, because they don't have to pay, you have to pay. They get it thrown in, yes? £43,350.
That's correct.
Right.
I think it's really important, Chair and Andrew, if I explain what we can charge for.
I'll come on to that. So I'm just trying to get, just following the numbers first, and then we'll come on to what you can and can't charge for. So you've billed you've billed Linda for £43,350, which comes out of your, which you're paid by Alan Skewis to absorb as part of your fee. Yes?
Yes.
Yeah, so ultimately it goes back to the public purse. But it's about 10% of the total cost of policing at West Ham so far this year.
As part of that special policing service, yes.
Great, good. Okay, and then the total cost for policing West Ham last year was £525,526, and the year before that, £429,284. That's when at the old ground.
That's correct.
Right? And what West Ham paid you, or not paid you, paid the Met for last year was £45,874, and the year before that, £98,801.
Mm. That's correct, yes.
Correct, yes. And if we scale that up across London, the net cost to the Met after the contributions from football clubs, or in this case Linda, is over £5 million, isn't it?
I would say that the net cost of policing football across London because it extends beyond the grounds. It's those clubs that travel through because of the transport network. I would put the cost of policing football as a whole closer to £8 million across London, of which, including Wembley National Stadium, we probably recover through special policing services about £700,000. But I think it's really, really important that we are clear about what it is we can charge for, because it is clearly defined in law.
All right, I'll come to that. So let's just stick with the figures just given me, because the previous answer I had was the net figure was 5 million, but you're now telling it's even more. If it was 5 million, and the higher figure you've given us now, that equates to getting on for 100 police officers, equivalent wages across the whole of London, doesn't it?
It's certainly the equivalent wages of a number of officers in that figure. Yeah. I haven't worked exactly.
So, you know, that's three or four extra officers for Borough. You didn't have to bear that cost.
It is the salary cost, whether that would equate to... Yeah.
And if we look at the Chelsea game, the number of officers you deployed there was getting on for 500, wasn't it? The Chelsea-West Ham game.
Yeah, I think it's 520 officers.
Yeah, and that's equivalent to the entire police force of an out-of-London borough, isn't it? Pretty well.
A day's work, fair, for probably some boroughs, yes.
Yeah, so it's quite a drain on police resources, isn't it?
Absolutely, and that's one of the key points we make, that football... Now, it's really, you know, in terms of that, crime and disorder around football is, like any crime and disorder, is a key role for police to address. So there's a proper responsibility for us to do
that. So, I mean, this comes back to, you can probably guess where the question's going. You're only allowed to charge basically within the curtilage of the football premises, aren't you?
It's a bit more complex than that. We can only charge in certain circumstances. Charge for policing under a Section 25 of the Police Act 1996 for special policing services.
Yeah.
They have to be requested by an agency. They are discretionary, so a chief constable doesn't have to provide them. Mm-hmm. Where we can charge has been defined in two High Court cases. The first one is Leeds United versus West Yorkshire Police in 2013, and that defined that it was on land that's owned, leased or controlled by the stadium operator of the club in that case. That was further defined this year in Ipswich Town versus Suffolk Constabulary, which further defined that owned, leased or controlled, and also differentiated that we could only charge for what's called really preventative policing, where we're there in case something happens, as opposed to operational reactive policing, where that's our duty. A bad thing happens, we get called, we respond to it, so we can't charge for that. So in terms of the West Ham position, where we are asked by the stadium to provide special policing services, the Stoke game, we can then charge for those officers that are deployed on the land owned, leased and controlled. That is what London Stadium 185 have done, the £43,000. But what I would say is the policing of football, the Olympic Park, much of that area is not land-owned, leased or controlled, therefore we can't charge. The policing of someone like Stoke starts from, if you were to include the British Transport Police, from the moment they get on the transport network. We deal with them in central London, so we deploy officers, and it'd be remiss if we didn't. We deal with them as they come across, to whichever train station. And I've already explained that for a match like Chelsea or for Stoke, that us getting used to the geography, the norms of that, we have had to deploy more officers because we can't be as forensic, we can't be as intelligence driven about where the issues would be. So yes, we've had to deploy more officers. They are a drain and one that we would not want to take from boroughs, because that's where they come from. And we will charge whenever we can. And I have to say, where we've been asked by London Stadium 185 to do it, we have done. And there has been no reluctance on their part to pay. Where the money comes from is
your concerns.
It's about me making sure that we charge appropriately. And the point I will come back to, and I think you make that point well, is that the policing of football globally is not just about West Ham. You know, if you include all of the specialists and all of the crossing of London that goes on, that's a massive drain on policing, not only in cost, but in terms of the people that are taken from, whether it's Bromley or Hillingdon or Camden.
Well, that's the point. If you didn't have to spend that £7 million on policing, we could spend that on more officers.
We could, but I would also say there are important things where there are this small minority of people who are intent upon crime and disorder around football. There is an absolute obligation on us to deal with those. We do. Mm-hmm. You've heard about the banning orders, and where we're asked to, and where people have, you know, around that safety contribution, we will take part and do so. And whenever we're called, we will go to deal with crime and disorder.
The Mayor, in answer to a previous question I put to him, has said that he supports full cost recovery of policing operations for football. Do you agree with that?
I think that, you know, with a multi-billion pound business that is football, there should be a greater contribution made. There are some things which are very clear that the police should do. You know, bad people committing crime, that's what the police are expected to deal with, and we absolutely step into that. But where you know, we are having to put these huge deployments, this Saturday coming alone, probably 400 to 500 officers deployed policing football across London, whether that's at one of the home games in London, whether that's people transiting through the central London stations around that, that's a massive drain on policing. And yes, I think it's my view that football as a whole, and we would ask that there's the ability to us to charge is extended, because it is quite narrow, and I think I've been clear about where that is.
So we need to change the law.
I think we need to be clear about making a greater contribution.
Yeah. Okay. So Karen, you don't have to pay anything for policing your games.
That's not true. I pay all the costs.
So that £43,000 that we mentioned earlier, you'll be paying.
Well, I pay £2.5 million a year, which covers all those costs.
Right. So that's all thrown into your overall contract. So no matter how many police officers are deployed or not, you don't pay any more.
No, I've already covered it in the £2.5 million that I pay. That it covers the cost of policing, security, maintenance, electricity, utilities, and so on.
So when BJ talks about these figures that it's costing the Met, costing Londoners to police your business, do you think you should be paying more?
Well, I think that, as you heard that Commander Harrington has said, there were two cases that were brought about to change the law in relation to what football pays for policing, and both of those weren't successful.
Yeah, well, so, that's what the law says. I'm not disputing what the law says.
So
I'm asking, do you think there's a moral obligation on West Ham when so many London police officers are deployed to police your games, supporting your profits? Don't you think there's a moral obligation to cough up a bit more?
Well, I think there's a couple of things I would say to that. First of all, it's not just West Ham that are not.
No, of course, I accept
that. We abide by the law, and football clubs abide by the law, and they pay what is due to be paid. The other thing I would say is that football clubs contribute billions of pounds to the UK economy through their taxes and the way they run their businesses and the national insurance they pay and so on. And some would argue that that's all that's all taken care of in the contributions that they make. This is not an industry that just sucks out of the system. It puts an awful lot back in.
Well, you can afford to pay £20.5 million in a transfer fee and all but £80 million in a wage bill. I think police officers come a bit cheaper than that.
But
don't you think it's a moral obligation to pay something towards this?
All of our assets are people, whether that be on or off the pitch. And our whole sole purpose of our business is to attract the best talent, to put on the best entertainment.